Thank you very much, Polly. Good morning, everybody. Firstly, just apologies from Jamie Boyton. He's our executive chairman, was going to be presenting this today, but we actually have our board meeting on today, so could not be here. Before I get on to Sukari, I want to take you a little bit through the business and give you a bit of an overview and a background on Capital Drilling, and then we'll get on to some of the more current topics within the business. Capital Drilling was founded in 2005 by an enterprising drilling manager, Brian Rudd. Started out in Tanzania, primarily in greenfields exploration drilling. Now, as Brian delivered to these various companies, he got into the delineation drilling, and then because he was still continuing to deliver really good results on that operation, can you do the blast hole drilling? Why not? We'll take on these projects. So the business has sort of evolved over time as we've continued to deliver for the mining companies that we're working for into what is today a primarily a production drilling business. So if you look at the pie chart in the middle here, the darker blue colour there is the proportion of blast hole drilling within our business right now. So we are essentially a mineral drilling services business, and then depending on where we are in the cycle, you get adjustments in terms of the actual proportion between the blast hole and exploration drilling. As the exploration drilling eases off, you get a greater proportion of the actual revenue coming from the base business, shall we call it, which is the blast hole business, that longer term contracts. It's quite a good diagram, this one, because it gives you a visual idea of the activities that we get involved in. So if you start off in the top left-hand side there, this is exploration drilling. This is out in greenfields. This is helping the geologists to find new deposits. Then the next one along gives you an idea of when they start getting into delineation programs, the increase in activity. You've found an ore body. You're now trying to get a much better idea of what's actually happening underground around that ore body. Then further on from that, you get into the actual mining operation, and we start doing the blast hole drilling, the grade control drilling, and in some cases we're doing the dewatering as well. So we're drilling horizontal holes into the walls, and also doing the dewatering actually around the pit to reduce the amount of water that's flowing into the pit operations. Follow-on services from that one, you logically start getting involved in the drill and blast activities themselves. So we're loading the blast holes, bringing the materials onto site, the detonators, the boosters, etc. So you get a continual increasing in services on these operations as you continue to prove yourself as a good mining operator. We'll touch on this further on, but you get logical bolt-on activities as well in terms of when you start doing 2 kilometre deep holes, you start actually doing the work to do the positioning of the holes. So you've got special tools you put down the hole to know accurately where the actual hole position is at that time. We have multi-year contracts at Tier 1 mines. We just announced the extension at Sukari. This is a 5-year extension. This is a very large, long mine life operation. All of our operations are working at very good all-in sustaining costs. They are highly profitable mining operations. So if you look at Sukari in Tanzania, we've got the Acacia operations at North Mara, and then the Anglo Gold Ashanti mines at Geita. These are all good, absolutely solid open pit mining operations. In there at the Geita operations, continuing on from our extensions from not only doing the surface drilling, we're actually doing the underground exploration drilling there as well. Back when in the exploration boom that happened 2008-2012, the business expanded out into some quite challenging projects. So Africa is absolutely our home turf, but whenever there are opportunities that are large, long scale, and typically challenging, and again, this is from our proven ability to really get the job done in challenging environments, we've gone out and done projects like Reko Diq in Pakistan, and recently we've been working with Nevsun in Serbia. Sorry, can I have a drink? And the Nevsun drilling was 2.3 kilometres deep. So this is some seriously challenging and not very easy geology as well. So we've got a reputation within the industry for taking on some really challenging jobs and getting the job done. Similarly, the work in Chile was really high altitude. We're talking about 5,000 metres RC drilling. So you can imagine when you're trying to do large quantities of airflow at those sorts of altitudes, it's pretty difficult. A little bit on strategy. There are lots of macroeconomic slides out there, but the key thing for me right now is we are producing more gold than we are finding. Now that can't continue, and the only way to actually go back and find more of that gold is through the drill bit. So ultimately, there's going to be more drilling. And this is what we're seeing now, is the budgets are increasing, and it's not only for the juniors and the exploration companies, junior and mid-tier exploration companies, this is for the mining companies as well, so in around the brownfields, around their existing mine sites. So we're seeing increased activity at Sukari, increased activity at Gator, because the ounces are going out the door, and they need to continue to find more ounces. So the period between 2012 to 2016 was tough for the mining industry, without a doubt. Exploration budgets dropped. They now need to catch up. About a year ago, we were thinking about what is our next logical move. Within the east coast of Africa, if you look at the countries that we're operating in, Tanzania and Egypt, there's only a handful of mines. If you look at West Africa, within West Africa, there's over 100 mines. The operating environment within Tanzania has been challenging, a little bit uncertainty. So what do we do about this? So we decided a year ago, West Africa is a logical place for us to mobilize to. So the first half of this year, we've been a logistics company. We've been relocating rigs back across into West Africa because you can go and talk to a client, potential client, and say, yes, we can do drilling for you, but unless you've got rigs on the ground, and particularly in those environments, and say, well, when's it actually going to be here? They're not going to trust and say, yes, we can deliver, we can start on this date. We had to have the rigs on the ground. So the first half of this year has really been mobilization. Get the rigs across, get ourselves established with yards, and then get up and running with our first few wins. And that's exactly what we've done. So this time last year, we had 15 drill rigs in West Africa. By June, we had 26. We had yards set up in Yamoussoukro in Côte d'Ivoire. We've got another full yard set up at Syama. We've got operations. The Syama operation is a long-term one. And we're up and running. We're already winning good quality contracts in West Africa. It was absolutely the right move, and you know, to be honest with you, I'm surprised at the rate that we're actually picking up business. 1 year, 15 rigs, 26, we're going to have 31 by the end of the year, and we've already got contracts in multiple countries. So the contract wins, Resolute at Syama, and that's both surface exploration drilling and underground. Kinross and Tasiast. Kinross, we're doing exploration, we're doing grade control, and we've had blast hole rigs operating there as well. Recently, Hummingbird, and then the most recent one we've had with Syama as well. And a bit of a mixture in, good to have the nickel one in there, gives us a bit of a diversity as well, away from gold, not only gold operations. So the revenue contribution, 2017 from West Africa was 13%, by the end of this year, 25%. So quite a significant change in strategy for us, and we've done a really good job of getting across there, getting set up, and actually getting operating. Our strategic focus areas, long-term contracts. Every time we've got a contract, it continues to get rolled over, and this is through delivery. We have a fantastic production team. Unfortunately, you know, Sukari is our absolute showcase operation, and unfortunately where it's located, nobody sort of drives by that part of Egypt all that often. But when you go and visit this operation and see what we're actually doing on that site, it's an absolutely cracking operation. It is just day in, day out, absolutely delivering for that client. So we want to do more of this. They're bread and butter operations for us. Every year we sit down with the client, what's the budget going to do? These are the meters. We're very, very consistent. We want to increase our rig utilization. So right now, In terms of instant growth, we have 40 rigs that are not being utilised. So, and these are primarily exploration rigs. So we have the opportunity, if we are picking up exploration projects, we can mobilise in there and we don't actually need to spend any capital. So this move to West Africa, the continuing conversations with the opportunities are coming up. Every time we pick up one of these projects, we don't need to go and spend a whole heap of new capital to put the rigs in there to get going. Touched on expanding into West Africa. What else? So the business has been quite enterprising. As we've been going to these remote projects around the world, we've been getting into things like satellite communications. Why? Because we weren't getting service properly. We had to have really good communications outside, so we've got a satellite business. The other one, if you're talking to an exploration geologist, if you start thinking about the conversations you're having with them and what their budget is, what do? Well, we produce a core, and then they take that core and they need to get results on that core. What is in within that core? What are the, you know, what are the grades? What other materials are in there? So we now have an alliance there, a strategic partnership with MS Analytical. They have a large full-service hub lab in Langley, in Canada, and they are pulling samples from around the world. So the ability to talk to our client and say, we can handle logistics of getting your sample from wherever it is in the back end of Mauritania all the way to the lab, and you only need to talk to one company about this. We will make sure that it happens. So when we have a truck going out to a drill rig with fuel and rods and everything else on it, why not put the core on the back and that goes back to the separate lab and they continue handling it from there. So these are just logical adjacencies. Further to this, we've got very good relationships with our clients. They trust what we're doing. And they're talking with us, they're saying, would you be interested in doing underground services? And this is the full mining. This is the load and haul, the drill and blast and the underground operations. You're already in there. You understand us. You understand our mining operation. You're delivering for us. Will you continue to do this in something that's right alongside where you are right now? Absolutely. Similarly, for mining operations, in the drill and blast side, you've got two contractors that are involved in delivering one outcome, which is fragmented rock. There's the opportunity for us to partner with explosive companies and say, we will give you a guaranteed price for broken rock at a certain level of fragmentation. So instead of them saying, okay, can you guys go and do the drilling for this and you guys do the blasting for this, go and talk to one group and say, okay, we need to produce this amount of broken rock this month. They absolutely, when it comes to budgeting for the following year, they absolutely know what their prices are going to be. And we're looking at doing this through JVs. We don't necessarily need to take on whole new areas of expertise within the blasting side of it all. There are very good partners that we can work with. And again, being in the industry for the length of time that we have, we know the people that we can trust that are actually going to deliver and deliver the similar level of standard that we do. So 2018, contract wins. Still showing 20 minutes. Have I still got 20 minutes? De Beers in Botswana, great little contract. I mean, I love this business. I mean, I get photographs every so often from the camp, you know. So these guys are out in the bush in Botswana and they've got the tents and the campfire and they're cooking up the breakfast and it's just, it's a great industry. You know, you come and do these things, but I would rather be with the team in Botswana, I can tell you. Sama Resources, absolutely, Nickel One. Hummingbird, you know, that's looking like an absolutely cracking project. And then, you know, maybe glimmers of hope within Tanzania. We're starting to see after what has been, you know, 2 years now of really nothing happening there. Graphics is drilling there, you know, are we starting to see things turn around? I'd like to hope so. I'm not definite yet, but starting to head in the right direction. So, you know, the team's been doing a great job of picking up new business. And again, a lot of this is in the back of reputation. Financials. And my background is a mining engineer, so I'm not going to go into a lot of the details on this because I'll probably get it wrong, but we will cover it. So really, the highlights has been, the first part of the year has been a successful transition into West Africa. The setting up of those yards, getting the rigs in, picking up those first few contracts and getting them going. Really good result as to where we are at this point in time. We've had exploration contract wins, not only in West Africa, but also in Tanzania and also with De Beers in Botswana. And you're going to see this translating in the second half as increased utilization. So the first half of the year, drill rigs on the sea don't produce meters. So you're going to get lower utilization. Then the second half, you know, as we get back up and running, we're back onto the growth path. We're going to see increasing utilization. There's a term in here, an acronym called ARPOR. It's a really important one within the drilling industry. Average revenue per operating rig. So if you start looking at your individual drilling operations and trying to understand what really makes them tick, for each one of their drill rigs, how many meters is it doing each month, and are you getting reasonable revenue for it? Okay, so really good metric for them, and it's continuing to improve. So, interesting enough, half one, as you'd expect, there's been a reduction in revenue because the drill rigs have been on the water. But at the same time, I've actually seen an increase in margins because our long life contracts that we have, we continue to refine and we continue to improve and we continue to improve our productivity. There's a lot of discipline in what we do in terms of managing our operations and our costs. One of our key guys that runs our operations is ex-military, and he runs it like a military operation. So EBITDA percentage has improved. It actually speaks for itself. The numbers are logical in terms of, okay, you've had rigs on the water, you've had a reduction in revenue, but you've actually seen that discipline and improvement in your operations during that period. So you've tightened the belt and made sure you still delivered despite the fact, well, knowing the fact that the rigs are on the move. So that improvement in our operating has seen improvement in our gross margins and improved EBITDA and NPAT, despite the weaker revenue, continuing on those themes. And I think the interesting one here is that despite the fact, in looking at half 118 on the other side there, despite the fact we've had a leaner period during the first half, we've still delivered net cash. So we've had all those rigs on the water and you've been putting costs into actually getting things up and running in a whole new region, and yet we're still making money. So we've had a flat first half, but now we're picking up contracts and we're on a roll again. Capital expenditure, interesting enough, it's been pretty consistent. If you look all the way through those through the lean periods there, we're roughly 10 to 12 million per year, of which it's typically half and half sustaining and growth. I can't comment on next year because we're having the board meeting today, but that's gives you a bit of a feel for how the business has been going for the last few years. We've got a strong balance sheet. Jamie has got an incredible finance brain, and he runs things conservatively, as you should do for a business like this. We're net cash, and we'll continue to be net cash unless we pick up a really solid long-term project that really supports a reason why we're going to debt. Okay. We're paying a dividend consistently. So it's increased. So the policy, the board will aim to approve an annual dividend of 25 to 75% of free cash flow after investment activities. We increased the dividend this year, so final dividend of 1.2 cents. And we had initial interim dividend of 6 cents, which was up on the previous year. So quarter three, as we're showing in that first half, it really showed what was going on. Again, the rigs on the water, reduced utilization, but the base business was continuing to deliver and deliver well. Q3, absolutely, we're seeing that return to growth as the rigs are getting out there. We've seen 12% increase in revenue on Q2. Continue to deliver the dividend, and we're in a strong cash position. And recently updated our guidance, revenue guidance, 105 to 115 million to the year. Competitors, bit of an interesting one in terms of competitors. There isn't really another full-service drilling company of our scale in Africa. So we're the biggest full-service, and I mean exploration, grade control, blast hole drilling, blast hole services, underground operation within Africa. And again, I think the notable one here is we're we're trading on some pretty easy looking multiples there, and we're paying a 3% dividend. So conclusions. Macro side, we're in a good part of the cycle, and I think we're going to continue to be because of that whole issue around the fact that, you know, really people are still producing more gold ounces than they're actually finding, and the only way you're going to find more ounces is by through the drill bit. And then from our side of it all, we've got a set of really solid base operations that is producing really good cash flow, and we've just relocated into West Africa where there are 100 operations and there are 300 exploration projects, so it's the right market. We've already started picking up new contracts, and we'll continue to do that. Any questions?
Stuart Thomson, thank you very much indeed.
As Stuart said, any questions, just raise your hand and the microphone will be brought to you. Thomas Coleman coming from the back of the room to bring the microphone. Gentleman on the front row here, please. Thank you. Just wait till the microphone comes to you, sir, please. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the presentation. Your utilization rate, 53%, seems quite low. With the industry spending on the way up, where do you see that in the next 18 to 24 months going? And do you see any pricing power at the moment? It looks like revenue's been stagnating, but could there be double leverage here with pricing power and utilization going up? Thank you.
Good question. Yeah.
Really good question. So we're continuing to do tendering activity right now. So there are lots of tenders coming up for plenty of activity that's actually going on within the West Africa region. On the pricing power side of it all, there is it's early stages, and I think we'll only see genuine pricing power when you start to see those other idle rigs, as well as their own, starting to be fully utilised in the market. So I think it's going to come. I don't think it's quite there yet.
But 53% on a fleet utilisation rate is low, isn't it? I mean, it's just sitting there idle, not being used.
Correct. Yep.
But you've done that for a reason, to plan for forays into other territories?
2012 to 2016, I think if we go back to where we were in expenditure back in 2012, back to it there. That one there.
Yeah.
So back in 2012, we were at 21 billion. We're only getting back to sort of 10 billion now. And I think...
So you didn't want to sell the kit and offload it all when you knew that you were going to be back in the game?
Absolutely. So
right.
Look, the interesting thing right now is, versus a lot of the other exploration companies, is still net cash. We survived that 2012 to 2016 in very, very good condition. So in terms of our position right now to go forward, we can expand. We can take on new projects without having to go further into debt, and we're not going to be chasing funding. We have got those 40 rigs, and that primarily comes back from 2012. We haven't added many rigs from then. So this is really a little bit of a... I don't like using the word legacy, because these rigs are in good condition. So we are ready to go, and we've only just got into the right area. So the... We're starting to see that uptick now because we've got into the patch that's growing. You know, Tanzania right now, there's only one, maybe two projects that are actually drilling. Egypt, there's only the one operation. Kenya's not all that strong. We're only really starting to get into the right patch.
So another way to look at it, you're well-resourced for the future.
Yeah, absolutely.
One more question, please.
Sorry, we're well-resourced and we've just arrived in the right territory.
In the right territory. Sir, on the front row.
Thank you for your presentation. I would like to ask you to take me through the sales process. When you actually acquire the commodity, how do you actually sell this, and what methods do you go through to sell that?
So sell so typically it's from relationships. So exactly right now there's the Mines to Money conference, talking to the various exploration companies, understanding where they're at, what they're up to, and making them aware. And a critical thing for us with West Africa was an awareness thing, because this is new territory for us. So we had to make sure that we were on the tender lists. And not only that, but they also need to know that we had the drill rigs in country. So we'd been looking at West Africa for a while, but the logical question from the geologists is saying, you know, okay, we want to start drilling in March. Okay, we can do that. Well, where are your rigs? There's a couple in Tanzania, and there's some here, and we'll bring them across. And really, everybody knows what it's like to operate in Africa, and there's always the rubber band as to when you can actually start if you're bringing things into the country, you know, the freight and the customs and everything else. You have to be there ready to go. Hence the decision was made, we're going to be there. So that decision was made in December, we bring the rigs across, and then as soon as you get on the tender lists, away you go. And a lot of it now, again, many of these companies, is because we've worked for them apart in the past. They know that we deliver. You know, these are all challenging conditions, you know, where we're operating in Mauritania, and you know, they want to know that you can handle the wet season in, you know, the southern parts of West Africa when it comes through, and they want to know that you can handle the dry conditions in the back of Mauritania as well. Sorry, does that answer the question?
And you've answered all those questions right up to time, so just remains to say thank you very much, Stuart Thomson.
Thank you.